Hello and welcome to Ignite with Mwangala, with me, Mwangala Chakalashi Santos. Our guest for the show is a very special guest. He's no ordinary Zambian, by the way. He is the fourth Republican president of Zambia. He is no other than Mr. Rupiah Bwezani Banda. Mr. Banda is here with us to share his life, I would call fully lived. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Not fully live, because I'm still alive. I hope I'm still living.
Yes, you are. Yeah, but I mean, you can write a book about your life.
Thank you.
From being a farmer to becoming vice president, president of this country. And here you are sharing your life.
Yeah.
Now, you were president between 2008 and 2011. Did you ever dream that one day you'd be president of this country?
No. No, never. And you know, the funny thing is that even when I was in politics before that, before I became vice president, I think you will recall from the records that I was also foreign minister. I was minister of several other ministries. And going further down, I was a senior governor. I'm the first senior governor of Lusaka. There was no post known as senior governor. It was created by Dr. Kaunda to place certain senior people in that position. I was the first one of the three that eventually became senior governors, I think Lusaka, Ndola, and Kitwe. And then I was also diplomat. I was ambassador from 1964, I was ambassador to Egypt, and then went on to become ambassador to Washington, D.C., and then later became permanent representative to the United Nations, and so forth, so forth.
Mm-hmm.
So I have had the privilege of being a leader from the grassroots up to the apex of leadership in our country.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Now, becoming president, I know you've said it never crossed your mind.
Yes.
Were there any specific steps that you took that singled you out?
No, because the first step, my first step into political activity, I did not decide on that one. A group of people in Mtendere came to see me at my house at Chila Road here in Kavlonga. There were six of them. It was just before parliamentary elections, and they came to see me and said they wanted me to become the member of parliament for Munali.
Mm-hmm.
So I laughed. I said, why me? I'd never been I never wanted to be even an MP. I never thought I could make one because I didn't have the means to do so. So I said to them, why me? They said, no, we've been watching you and we've decided that that's you. We want to be our MP. I said, but I don't have the means. They said, you don't need the means. We are your means. We are the people organizing the party.
Mm.
And we will organize for you to become a member of parliament. That's how I went into active politics. Of course, once I got in for reruns and so forth, I had to make the decision and go on and fight the election. But to start with, I was invited by people in the constituency.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Now let's talk about your leadership qualities. Just before the interview, you were telling me how that your mother knew intuitively that one day you become a leader.
Yes.
Do you think you drew that from her?
Yes, all of us, every one of us, those listening and yourself who is interviewing me, all of us grow up in a certain way.
Mm.
And somebody notices things about you which you may not be aware of and perhaps talks about it. And in my immediate family, I do recall my mother many times saying, you are too kind, you know, why are you... always, if I come with friends to eat and bring the shima sometimes, we were a very poor family. We grew up in Zimbabwe in a place called Gwanda.
Mm.
And then when we were playing with friends, they came perhaps from poorer homes than I did. They would follow me home so that we could have lunch together. And my mother would notice this, because normally you want to eat the food alone or with a few of you.
Mm-hmm.
But my mother would notice this and say, you like your friends, it's good, I like your heart, and things like that. So I think my mother had a feeling that I was forgiving and that I was generous, and she always praised me for it.
Mm.
Yes.
Okay. So at 69, you retire you're back on your farm, and boom, yes, you're president of the country.
Not that boom, president of the country. It's a history which the country must hear about. Course, how did I become?
Of course, let's
yes,
go
yes, I was, you know, I'd left politics and retired. The main reason why I had moved from Lusaka, I used to live here in Kablongo on Chila Road.
Yeah.
And I had a miserable life after I lost my wife. Mm. I was married to Hope Mwansa Makuru, and then she was diagnosed with cancer, and then she passed on. So the months and years after that were very difficult for me. I used to sit in my house and really feel lost and lonely and so on. Then my children who come and visit me, at that time most of them had moved out of the country. They were working in South Africa. They would come to visit me and be with me. Or those who were here, they would come to visit me. But I wasn't comfortable. So I decided that I would move to my farm in Chipata, because my mother was still alive and my father was alive. And I thought, well, I have a house there. Why should I sit in this house here when I can earn a living from it by renting it out? And then go and stay and see my mother and father. They're getting old, and enjoy them. And so that's how I ended up in Chipata. It was when I was there that something triggered somebody to look for me and ask me to come and join him in government. And this is the late President Mwanawasa.
Mm-hmm.
President Mwanawasa sent one of his officials to follow me to the farm and ask me if I can come and see him. Of course, I was frightened because I thought I had done something wrong. He wanted to admonish me or something.
Mm-hmm.
When I got there, he said to me, you know what? I have a lot of problems. Organizing my campaign. In the last campaign, which I just won, I won with a very narrow margin. And I realized that I need some help from certain people.
Mm-hmm.
And when I consulted a number of my friends, everybody's pointing to you to help me. If I can get hold of the Eastern Province, if the Eastern Province can support me, in the next election, this was 3-4 years before the next election. He had just won the election 1 year before. So now he was preparing for that. He asked me if I could join him, and not join him in active politics, but remain there in Chipata, but help him to organize the Eastern Province and so on. I was very touched that of all the people, he chose me.
Mm.
Later on, I asked him, who told you to find me?
Yeah.
He told me a number of names, but one which I would like to mention Akashambatwa.
Mm-hmm.
Akashambatwa kept telling him, Akashambatwa was one of his top advisors, political advisors, kept telling him that if you want to get the Eastern Province, talk to Mr. Banda. I'm sure he can help us. So it was. He told me that he got the courage to approach me based on that strong advice, persistent advice. Also, the president himself, President Mwanawasa, was my friend before, not politically. He was a lawyer in Indola at the time. I think along the line, he either had married or had a child with a lady with my name.
Mm-hmm.
So he called me Mulam. We always, wherever we met, he was always a busy man. He said, Mulam, how are you? And I said, and then along the line, I got arrested for the zero option, if you recall.
Yes.
And I was in Chimbwagaira.
Mm-hmm.
And he came to see one of his people who were detained together with me.
Uh-huh.
He came to see him at the prison. And I was there too. So he came. And he said, Mulam is here as well, I want to see him. And that's when I didn't realize where this was leading up to. But of course, he never forgot that.
Mm-hmm.
And I never forgot that. So when he came to ask me to support him,
mm-hmm.
I said, but this man, when I was in prison,
he cared
a lot for me.
Yeah.
So it was easy for me to say yes. So I think it's important that I have this opportunity to recognize the fact that President Munawasa is the one that actually picked me to become his vice president and ultimately to become his successor.
Wow. Now, what are some of the memories that you remember, you know, having been president? What are some of the fondest memories that you'd like to share with all of us?
Ah, there's so many. There are so many. In fact, that's one of the things many friends are telling me, why don't you sit down and record some?
And write a book.
Mm-hmm. Because it's little things that...
that matter.
Yes, but I said, perhaps it shouldn't be me. I've been talking to a lot of my young friends who are close to me, who know me better. And I said, why don't you write? Because they always come to me and remind me, do you remember this trip we made to such a country? Mm-hmm. Do you remember this and that? Do you remember this incident? Mm-hmm. And I said, but you remember it. Why don't you write about it for me? Mm-hmm. I will write my book when eventually I'm ready. Uh-huh. But you remember a lot of things about what I did, just like my current colleagues. They also know they should write also about me. All the people that know me and know the little things that I've done with them, they should write them. But personally, like I told you, I remember this incident of President Munawasa coming to visit us in prison, and then eventually, many years later, calling me to come and become his vice president, or calling me to come and help him in his campaign and eventually become his vice president. But also, you know, I was in the struggle for independence. I was very young at that time, the ages of 18, things like that. We were very touched by the bravery and the commitment of our leaders at that time, which is Dr. Kaunda. And many of us used to go to Chilenje to see him at his office. Many young people, I was at Munali then, on weekends, would say, let's go to Chilenje to go and see our leader. But would find a lot of people and difficult to see him. But when he comes out, he will wave his handkerchief and...
Also, it started way back, the handkerchief. Found it?
Yes. Wow. He has always... you know, that man, not enough has been said or done about him. Yeah. That's why, ultimately, you recall that with the help of our president now, I was able to stage a birthday party for him and brought a number of leaders. I'm sure you recall this only a year or 2 years ago when he had his 95th birthday. And because when you talk about him, it opens my mind, emotions, etc. We come a long way together. We always looked up to him. So those days, whenever you would see KK, it was very fascinating. Then led to independence in 1964. I was one of the young people who were in the stadium as we received the title deeds to Zambia. As the British government lowered their flag down and raised the Zambian flag and the national anthem. That's a very emotional period for any politician.
Oh, yeah.
I witnessed that one. I was only 21 then, I think, at Independence Stadium. Yes, and then there are many other occasions that I can. You wouldn't have enough time to do this.
Yeah.
But then I become president.
Yeah.
And I say to myself, what are you going to do? I came from home. I'd given up politics and I'd gone to my farm and I was in my fields working in Sparta all the time and so on. And then I find myself in this. So that occasion is very special to me. Yes, and as you know, in the process thereafter, I met, because I told you that I moved from here to Chipata because I was lonely. I'd lost my wife, Hope, and then I went back to Chipata, and I'm sitting there. I have a little cousin and a girl, not a cousin, a granddaughter. And he kept saying to me, Ambuya, who is cooking for you today? I told her, you come and cook. And she said, no, today I'm busy and so on, but on Thursday or whatever the day was, I can come with my friends and we can prepare for you. If you buy this and that for us. I said, I don't know how to buy those things. I gave her money. She went to buy. Her name is Annalena. She's now married. She's got her own children. She's married to a Mr. Msonda. And I remember this because it led to my marriage with my current wife.
Current wife, yeah.
So she She then comes with five girls, four girls and herself. I wasn't there. I had gone to a meeting of the Chamber of Commerce in Chipata. You know, once you're interested in organization, mm-hmm. you always do something. Yeah. So in Chipata, I joined the Chamber of Commerce. So that night, I was supposed to have dinner with them at about 7. And I come back at about 8, the food is not ready. Mm-hmm. The women are chatting. One of them was doing the hair of my current wife. Uh-huh. So I told her, but you said you were coming to cook for me. What is all this?
Yeah.
So I said, no, we got carried away, but the food is going to be ready soon and so on. And of course, the young ladies were chatting me up. They knew that I had no wife. Mm-hmm. And chatting me up. And the only one who wasn't talking to me, mm-hmm. the one whom I eventually married. But, of course, became curious. Mm-hmm. I was interested in her too because she was silent. So when we finished our dinner, I had a vehicle, an Isuzu, packed all the girls up and going in, and strategically mm-hmm. I made sure that this one who didn't talk to me,
she dropped last.
I would talk to her last. I took all of them, dropped them their various places, and I asked them, who are you? You were not talking. Mm-hmm. So I'm a teacher. I teach in Chiparamba, mm-hmm. at a little school in Chiparamba. So, by coincidence, I'm from Chiparamba. My uh-huh. parents originally come from Chiparamba. Are you from Chiparamba? I asked her. Mm-hmm. She said, no, I'm not from Chiparamba. I was born in Kitwe. Mm-hmm. My parents come from Isoka. But my brother works for the government here in Chipata.
Yeah.
That's he who invited me to come and stay with him and put me through school. Mm-hmm. Yeah, interesting for me. Oh, young lady like this is teaching my people in Chiparamba, and she's from Isoka. So as I was dropping her off, she said, goodbye. I will see you next time when I come.
Yeah.
I said, why next time? Why can't we see you again? He said, no, I'm actually going to Jalimbana. Uh-huh. I'm doing
A course in teaching,
yeah. Postgraduate, higher than primary school. Mm-hmm. I go every holiday. So I said, when are you going? And she said she was going on Friday, I think. I said to her, but this is a coincidence. Uh-huh. I was also going to.
Were you going to Lusaka?
I'm teaching young people to. But anyhow, we said we should tell stories about our life.
So we
traveled together, uh-huh. myself and my nephew and her. We took her up to Jalimbana. We got to become very good friends, started talking and so on.
Yeah.
And so I started to know her program when she's back in Chipata. Mm-hmm. And then one thing led to the other. And she's my wife now and gave uh-huh. me these two. The twins.
Uh-huh. So before you lose your thoughts,
yes.
what struck you the most? I mean, you redefined this thing we call age.
Yes.
And I mean, if you look at your wife,
you look at
the number of years.
Yes.
That is between you and her.
Yes.
I mean, what was very striking about her? What were you looking for in a woman?
I told you that when we were all seated together, uh-huh. everybody was busy chatting uh-huh. me up. Uh-huh. And they were irritating me. The one who didn't talk to me, I don't know. I can't explain that. But okay. I was impressed that uh-huh. she was very proud to be a teacher.
Yeah.
She was very proud to teach in a rural area. She lived in a very remote place in the middle of Chiparamba
yeah.
at a little school and where she taught. Mm. Chiparamba is where the headquarters of the Chewa people in that area. Mm. So I was impressed by that here's a young Zambian mm-hmm. willing to serve our country, and a young Zambian who left the Copper Belt, the urban area, because most of us don't want to go to rural area,
not, yeah.
and followed her brother who invited her to go to school mm-hmm. and did well at school and became a teacher and agreed to teach in a rural area. All those things impressed me. I think, of course, besides her beauty, she's a good-looking young lady.
Of course.
Yes.
That had to count also.
And then later on, of course, because she remained in Chipata, I used to come from Chipata mm-hmm. to hear, to board meetings and to check my rentals, collect my rentals from the properties that I had at the time and so on. And so I say to her, you are in Chiparamba, mm-hmm. and you go to Ichipata town to buy your provisions and so on, mm-hmm. let me introduce you to my mother, mm-hmm. so that when you are coming through, my mother keeps the keys to my house,
yeah.
there's running water and mm-hmm. electricity and so on, you can stop here. I really genuinely okay. offered her that.
Because it wasn't a strategic move.
No, because I wasn't here. I was okay. And now when I look at it, it was a strategic move uh-huh. because my mother, which is the story I'm telling you, my uh-huh. mother got involved in this affair, of course. So she agreed. She said, tell your mother. Hmm. So I took her to the house where my mother was. I said, oh, and me and you. My mother, nah, I'm going to go where I'm. So, I didn't think that she would come.
Yeah.
A young lady living in Chiparamba in the middle of nowhere, mm-hmm. going to town. She would rather stay in town. If she has 2 days off, she would stay in town with her friends, go to nightclubs and so on. But by the time I went back after 1 month, she had been there twice.
Mm-hmm.
And she had spent 2 nights each time, the first time 2 nights, the other time, even 3 nights with my mother. And then my mother started uh-huh. talking to me about her.
She said, pay attention here.
Yeah, I said, ah, but in Mwana, my mother, Mwana Gazoja Parin, she told me. And she started encouraging me to marry her.
Yeah.
She said, you look lonely and so on. And, but I said to her, but she's young.
Yeah.
My children were older than her. I said, no. She's a good girl. And my mother, mm-hmm. which is the story that I want to tell you, my mother and my father were Jehovah's Witness, very staunch Jehovah's Witness.
Mm-hmm.
So before they can declare you to be good, you mm-hmm. must be a Jehovah's Witness. And it turned out that she was a Jehovah's Witness.
Oh, wow.
So during these days when they're together,
mm-hmm.
they would spend a lot of time talking about the Bible and what they should do for the people and so on. So that impressed my mother, and she wanted very much for me to have a Jehovah's Witness as well. So mm-hmm. when I came back and asked her, she said, oh, I forgot, I didn't even ask her whether she came,
mm-hmm.
because it was not my intention to. So my mother said, oh, am I here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we have spent a lot of time together. So Namaiwa Bwidonga. So I said, how do you know?
Choyamba
Nimboni. She is a Jehovah's Witness. She's a very honest girl.
Yeah.
She's very nice. Where can you find a young lady of her age going to instead of staying in town with her friends and going to nightclubs and going to drink? She comes and stays here with me and all that. She's a nice girl, think of it.
Mm.
That's how, so I said, even my mother approves.
Mm-hmm.
So, I can
Who am I to say no? The rest is history.
It's one of the incidences which I'm sure you wanted to know.
Of course. I was going to ask that, but it's like you read my mind.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, now, you are former president of this country.
Yes, ma'am.
But I'm sure you still have this country at heart.
Yes.
What is keeping you busy nowadays?
Well, you know, first of all, you know, idle minds
mm-hmm.
are no good. You know, all the time, you must do something.
Mm.
I was president, I was busy so much. Imagine the size of this country, 753,000 square kilometers of land, and I had to go to meetings there to meet chiefs and attend rally. It was really very, very tough. And so on. And then you've run all the ministries, all the parastatals. It was a very, very tough job. Then suddenly you're not president anymore. Mm-hmm. You've lost election.
Yeah.
I got to sit there and cry all the time and become bitter and say, who made me lose these elections? For me, I decided, that's it. You remember that night when the Chief Justice called me at about 1 a.m. to say that things are not looking very good.
Mm.
I think that it looks like, I said, tell me, what do you say?
Mm.
I think that you've lost the election. I said, well, that's the idea of elections.
Mm-hmm. In that moment, what were your emotions when you were told that things are not looking okay?
She told me, I didn't see. I didn't, because I was waiting for the results to come out of the Western province.
Yeah.
There were some results still in the Eastern Province from the valleys which had not come out. So my advisors and myself felt that when these come out, we will definitely be able to overcome the leadership of Mr. Sata. But According to the chair for the Electoral Commission, she said that they've calculated everything. It's not possible. That I'll make it, of course, as a shock to me.
You didn't expect it?
Yeah, I didn't expect it. I thought that I'd won that election. I'd done everything. Normally, when you are a president and the economy is going good, as it was going there. Of course, the opposition was busy saying it wasn't going good, but I think now they know what going bad of an economy is.
True.
But at that time, the economy was going good. Mm-hmm. We were mobilizing the country. Our mobilization campaign went very well. We had all the funding, and you can't believe from marketeers, all the people who were beginning to benefit from the economy.
Exactly.
From Kalingalinga, from Chiwama, and so on and so on. To bring money to us to win this election. So everything was going very well. We're pulling big crowds. A lot of people were coming to the ground. I think I had succeeded to a certain extent to unite the country.
Yeah, you did.
If you remember, my rallying cry was Rupiah Bwezani, president for all Zambia.
Yeah.
It was deliberate. Mm. It was to bring everyone. Mm. Every rally that I addressed all over this country, I told them, look, I am here to persuade you to vote for me because I've done this and that for you and I'll do this and that for you. However, it's up to you. In the end, you have to decide.
Yeah.
I more or less was preparing myself
for the outcome of
the election. Mm. I may not have realized it, but then I kept saying this to the people of Zambia that I have... it's up to you. Mm. Whatever you have seen what I've done. And I was sure that they would go. Of course, then comes the news at midnight from the chair of the Electoral Commission that no, it's not looking good, you've lost. So I was talking on the phone to her. My wife was lying on the bed. And I said to me, she said, what? And I said, we've lost this election.
Mm.
And my wife said, calm down. She said to me, cool down, that's how it is. Some win, some lose. Mm. So I said, what are you telling me? So I told her that tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, I'm having a press conference, and I want you to come. Immediately I picked up phone, I called Dixon Jere, who was my press person. I said, I've just finished talking to him, and doesn't look very good. Looks like we're out, and so on. And I want you to come now. And then I want you to get in touch with the Richard Chembe, get in touch with my political advisor and all my key people, and Dr. Sichinga. Everybody must come now.
Mm.
We have to prepare for the press conference tomorrow. So 2 hours later, we all met. I didn't sleep that night, as you can imagine. And then we went for the press conference. And I'd like you to go and look for that speech so you can read it again now so you understand.
Mm.
What I said in that speech, because it still remains a lesson to the young Zambians what to do when you're confronted with a situation such as mine. A lot of people, then and now, still think I was a fool to accept. There's many leaders in Africa mocked me. They said, you were the president, you had all the power, how could you concede so easily?
Mm.
Said, but I had already promised the people that the winner will be the winner. You look for this speech of mine, which I addressed at Mandevu, which was my last rally, at exactly 5 minutes to 18 hours. And in that speech, I said, all political leaders in Zambia, all opposition leaders, all those who want to be president, we have had the opportunity to talk to the Zambian people.
Mm.
And we have told them what we will do for them, we have told them what we can do for them, etc., etc. It is now up to the Zambian people to make the decision. And once they have made that decision, each one of us must commit ourselves to accept.
So you actually respected the wish for the Zambians?
Yeah, my wish. It was my wish also that whoever loses must lose.
And whoever wins must win.
Win. But whoever wins must respect those who have lost.
Exactly.
Which unfortunately, as you all know, what I went through
was
not the case.
Mm.
But The fact is, I promised that I would accept, and I did accept.
Mm-hmm. Now, talking about what you went through after you lost that election,
yes,
would you safely say you've forgiven and forgotten?
Of course, not forgotten. How can you forget? You've been called this, being dragged to court every day and so on. So it's very painful, and you've got children every day. They're seeing in the paper, they're hearing from their friends at school, oh, your dad stole this, your dad did that. It's a very traumatic experience that I went through. I can't forget that.
But forgive.
Forgive, yes. And you know, this is the message that my guiding star in Zambian politics, Kenneth Kaunda, taught us. On the 24th of October, 1964, Kaunda stayed at the stadium, at Independence Stadium. Let us not forget the bad things that happened to this country.
Yeah.
But let us forgive. Let us go forward. The first leader that I had, I was sitting very close to, saying we must forgive, even before President Mandela said it, before Desmond Tutu, before all the great leaders of Africa who have talked about forgiveness, Kaunda was the first one in 1964. And that never left my mind. So here I am now in Kaunda's seat, and I'm being persecuted, etc., etc. So I had to remember the strength that he gave to us young Zambians. I'm talking to young Zambians who tomorrow may become leaders of this country.
Exactly.
I'm saying the same thing. Once you have won, you've won on behalf of everyone. All those who voted for you, all those who didn't vote at all those who voted against you, everybody in Zambia, the 18 million people in Zambia, you become their father.
And regardless of their political affiliation.
Exactly.
Don't you think Zambia is now losing it? I mean, you...
Well, you want me to say it for you? Your question is loaded. Uh-huh. Yes.
I want you to say it for us.
Yes. No. Mm. I'm saying it. That, you know... It is obvious. It is very obvious that we are bitter against each other, and it's not a good thing.
Wow.
And I'm not ashamed to do this, to say this, that if we don't follow what those who came before us, like Dr. Kaunda, like Martin Luther King, like all these great people before, if we don't follow what they told us about this issue of forgiveness, this issue of love, this issue of peace, this issue of justice, we'll have problems. Don't talk about Zambia only. Just switch on, say, CNN now. Just switch on CNN, BBC, anything you switch on, and see what is happening in the world today because of hatred. And what is happening in the streets of America, what is happening in the streets of France, happening in the streets of England, can happen in all streets of any country in the world. If there is no love, there's no forgiveness. So for me, that is, and I say this all the time, in practical terms, that's what I try to do always, to advise my young friends who bother to ask me for my opinion as to where we should be going. We need all to go forward together as a people, regardless who is going to win. Once they have won, it is their duty to look after everybody. It is their duty to forgive the others. It is their duty to be fair in the distribution of the wealth of the country to everybody else.
Wow. Mr. President, I feel
I'll tell you a little story about this, since today is the day for confession.
Oh, yes.
There's a little story when I was president, when one afternoon my economic advisor came to me and told me, my chief of staff came to me and said, here, Mr. President, is a list of the people that are going to receive land in Serenje. In Serenje, there was 100,000 hectares of land, like there is all over the country. We had allocated 100,000 hectares for the government for any development. Mm. So in Serenje, we had been approached by an investor from Hungary who asked for 25,000 hectares. He wanted to start a factory for pigs, for making salami, Hungarian salami. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He wanted to do it in Serenje, in the farms there. So all he wants is 25,000 hectares. But he also wants us to give to Zambians around him another 25,000 hectares of Zambian farmers. He will teach them how to farm. He will teach them how to look after these pigs. He will put up factories for feeding the pigs, etc., etc. And they will grow the pigs and they will put them into his factory so he can make salami. Mm-hmm. Because he has got an order from Japan for this particular pig, which he wanted to grow here in Zambia. So to prepare this, they have chosen Zambia because I've met you, Mr. President, you mm-hmm. received me well, and I want to come and do this. Mm-hmm. So I was very excited, and I went, I called all my staff, and I said to them, we've got an interesting investment coming. Let's do this. Let's prepare 25,000 hectares, mm-hmm. announce to the Zambians, whoever wants a farm for growing pigs mm-hmm. and maize and all the raw materials for food, we give them, I think it was 20 hectares or 30 hectares, I can't remember. Mm-hmm. You give that to the Zambians, as many as we can within the 25,000 hectares. Mm-hmm. 25,000 we allocate to this person. Mm-hmm. On the understanding that he's going to bring the money into this country. Before we start giving him the land, the money should be in an escrow account mm-hmm. at the Bank of Zambia. Everything was agreed and prepared, everything. Of course, I've given my directive, I forgot about it. 1 year later, my colleague comes and said, oh, we have a list now, we finalized the list. And here, this is the land for the investor, mm-hmm. and we have informed him already. And this is the list of the Zambian. Mm-hmm. On the list was Rupiah Bwezani.
Your name was there?
My name. Uh-huh. I think you know the story. Others who are well read, they know mm-hmm. about it. There's the name of Rupiah Bwezani Banda, for president of Zambia. 150 acres. A farm to grow goats and the pigs and things like that. That's what struck me first.
Yeah.
Before I looked at the other names, I said, mm-hmm. is this Rupiah Bwezani me? He said, yes, it's you. And I said, but I didn't apply. You published the thing, and you said that you would
open it up for all Zambians.
For all Zambians. Uh-huh. I didn't apply. Why didn't you take my land and give it to the other people applying? And I noticed there was a little bit of discomfort and so on. And then they went further and said, please read the whole list. When I read the list, I found what a few of my friends mm-hmm. at State House, my colleagues, were also
on the list.
Allocated. I said, oh, I see. And they said, no, we thought that we must be an example. We're going to tell people to go farming and all this and so on. We thought that you should also have a piece of land and go there so that this project can go. We also wanted, say, 20 hectares. They meant well, mm-hmm. wanted to do this, wanted mm-hmm. to go farming as well, so we can help. But unfortunately for them, the other list were Zambians whom I didn't know, mm-hmm. a lot of Zambians from everywhere. And amongst the list was Membe. You remember our brother, member of the Post?
Of the Post, yes.
Newspaper. In the middle of the time when every day front page was Rupiah Bwezani, idiot, thief, what, mm-hmm. big stomach, what, mm. all kind of things. His name was on the list. And in the wisdom of those who were making the decision, they thought that we cannot give it to him because he's against mm-hmm. the president. So we thought you should know that we have eliminated him. And I told him, stop there.
Yeah.
Why do you eliminate him? Mm-hmm. Is he not a Zambian? He said, yes, he's a Zambian. Mm. But why did you eliminate him? So, because it's against our party. It's against the president. It's against this and that. I said, yeah, but he's still a Zambian. Who do you expect to be against me if he's not a Zambian? Yeah. Because he's a Zambian. Yeah. He's, I don't like what he says about me. I don't agree with him and so on.
But he's still a Zambian.
So can you bring that paper? Brought the paper and signed, reversed, give him the plot. Give him plot like all the others. The others, I didn't want to even to see them because I don't know them.
Yeah, yeah.
I went further, and I think Dixon Jerry has written about this. I went further and said, this one, remove them. Mm-hmm. This is from my staff at State House. This one, remove them. And say, this one, you are part of my staff. You are the people who made this decision. Take out all your names.
Exactly.
This project was for just ordinary Zambians who have no political influence again. It's one of the incidences that I did, and it is there on record.
Mm.
If you look in one of the articles that Dixon Jerry has written, mm-hmm. or the perhaps his book, I don't know, but I remember it was in public. This is the kind of thing that I would like you when you become president.
Thank you, I receive it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, now let's talk about Arabi and his dreams.
Yes.
We've talked about your political life. I think we've talked about your family life. But let's talk about your dreams.
Yes.
Do you think if you had to look at your dream chart or dream board, would you tick out everything as dreams that you've lived? Or do you still dream?
I'm one of the few people who whatever they wished for themselves, and it happened. If you become a president of a country,
of course,
that's all your dreams answered. Even if you didn't dream to be a president, the fact is I got the maximum amount of reward for anybody can dream for.
If you had to come back in this life, would you still want to come back and be president of this country?
You know people don't come back.
I know, but
so
we're just saying.
Why are you asking a hypothetical question?
Yeah, but if you had to, if God gave you a second chance to say, okay, you're going back.
I know
back.
God is capable of bringing me back, but yes. I don't think I'm one of those that is deciding to bring me back to do what? I've done my bit. Yes.
So is that a yes? Is that
my answer is that those that he brings back to become leaders like Mwangala, like all the future leaders that we have, and so that's what I just want that this country must continue to have good leadership.
Yeah.
Must continue to have leadership which puts us together, brings us together, which forgives. Yeah, because we are a human being. If we are together long enough, I'll offend you or you'll offend me.
True.
But in the process, we have to say to each other, we are humans, we have to forgive each other. And the Zambians have to learn that process also, they forgive each other, so that we can have this country together. See what happens to countries where they are going like this.
True.
Either because of color, or because of status, or because of belonging to a political party. Yeah, but we chose, we Zambians, all Zambians chose to have multi-party system. If I recall, the reason why the founders of the movement for multi-party democracy chose that name, because it reflected the feelings of the Zambian people. The Zambian people at that time, when we were moving from one-party state, which we had experienced and detested, and wanted to forget about it, decided that they would form a party called Movement for Multi-Party Democracy to reflect the feeling of the people. So I think that whatever is happening in this country, the fact that you belong to party A, and I belong to party B, and others belong to party C, D, and so on, that's what we chose to be.
Exactly, yeah.
So, if we chose to do that, then we would tolerate each other.
True.
Yeah, we'd forgive each other.
Yeah.
And while we're talking about forgiveness, I've never been so happy as when I read, I think only 2 weeks ago, ago when the president forgave thousands of people.
On Africa Freedom.
I urge him to do more, more. There's no need for people to be suffering in prison.
Yeah.
We don't have even the resources to keep the thousands and thousands of people in the prisons. when the people are outside themselves don't have food.
True.
So that good heart
should continue.
It must continue.
Wow.
Forgive. Don't listen to people.
Just forgive.
Yeah. Don't listen to people who are telling you, no, this one is against you. Yeah. How do you know that the one who's telling you no is not the one who's against you? It's trying to blind you.
I like that. Now, you've talked so much on love, on peace, on forgiveness. Yeah. And I know that your government was so much, you know, you really embraced or you believed in dialogue.
Yes.
Do you think you've done much to pass that on to probably upcoming leaders like ourselves?
That's why I came here today. I came here today, you know, I'm a tired man now.
Yeah.
I'm a retired man.
Uh-huh.
And so when my colleague, Ms. Mikatazo, came to me and said that they want to... I get a lot of requests, by the way, from a lot of TV stations and newspapers asking me to hold interviews such as this one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't accept them now.
Wow.
Yeah, and the reason is I'm tired.
Mm.
I'm tired, and also there's COVID out there. We don't want to be roaming around in the streets and so on. But when he said, this is from Father Chilinda, I said, now you have handcuffed me. I am going. I have to come.
Mm-hmm. And especially after coming on Ignite.
Why? Right? Father Chilinda is, sorry to embarrass him, but this is time to talk truth.
Yes.
Yeah, sorry to embarrass him.
Yes.
Even before this was built up, I remember he used to come and see me and say, my dream and my colleagues in the church is to start something
TV
like
station.
This.
Uh-huh.
And I'm so happy that finally I have seen it and participated in its activities. When I was at the peak of persecution, when some of the politicians were announcing on the news that if you see Rupiah Banda at any border post, arrest him.
Mm.
Don't allow him to cross the border. When my passport was taken away from me, that of my wife, when I was supposed to go to the hospital to check my health because of my age, and et cetera, et cetera, and people say, no, he's about to go into jail. He stole this, he did this and that. One of the very few people that was courageous enough to face Mr. Sata. You know, Mr. Sata was not easy for anybody just to go and talk to him.
Mm.
But he would go to him and say, what you are doing, Mr. President, is not fair. That man is your friend, and you know he didn't do what you're saying. And you know he deserves to go to the hospital. You know that he is a kind person. Why can't you be kind to him? That's why I would suddenly get a call from nowhere from Mr. Sata. I see on my phone, say, President Sata. He wants to arrest me a second time. And I would answer him and say, how are you, Mr. President? Arabi, how are you? He said, rest in peace. And I said, I'm okay. He said, have you been to see your doctor? But of course, he had been talking to me and say, I want you to go and see your doctor and I'll talk to the president.
Yeah.
So here's the president calling me now and saying, have you been to see your doctor? And I said, no, I haven't been to see my doctor. Why? I said, but you are the one who gave instruction to take my passport. Why do I go there? I was at the airport going to South Africa, and the immigration blocked me. They let Mrs. Banda go, but me, they stopped me. He said, forget about all that. I'm the president now speaking. Come and see me tomorrow. I'll give you your passport. There must be people in this country with a good heart to speak on behalf of those who can't speak for themselves.
Like Father Chilinda.
And there are many other people like Rupiah Banda who are suffering, who are stranded out there, who need a bit of help, just a little bit of help. And if people can sacrifice their popularity or their friendship with leaders, they should tell the leaders to help these people.
True.
And he's one of those. So I told Mr. Mikatazo, my sister, if his Father Chilinda, I'm coming.
True. Wow. Thank you on behalf of Father Chilinda.
Thank you.
Now, you're still a very powerful man. Do you help like Father Chilinda? You've talked about people that have...
You know, we haven't seen each other for a long time. I think you feel sorry for me that I'm tired. You can see I've grown a beard. I haven't moved from my house for 3 months.
You look okay. You look okay.
Well.
You're still Arabi
Thank
to many
you.
Of us.
Thank you.
Now, quickly, let's look at Africa.
So, you know, don't erase this issue of like people like Father Chilinda. people like Father Killian, they were doing things for this country.
Yeah.
He and his colleagues, the other fathers, mm. and yourselves, all of you, we must be helped without condition, without saying, if I help you, what are you going to do for me?
Yeah, what is in it for me?
It is the duty of all of us leaders to help people, regardless of what they will do for us. Because they will do something good for somebody else.
True, they'll pay it forward.
Yes.
Wow, that's so profound. I'm so touched. I'm asking myself, do I really help that much? Now, this is a lesson that I've learned from you. Now, let's talk about Africa. Do you think this is the Africa that our forefathers fought for? Are we living to the expectations, or have we?
You know, Africa has had a very turbulent history. Mm. We've gone through ups and downs. We've gone through coup d'etats. We've got revolutions. We've gone through all one-party state. We've gone through a lot of problems, and now we're going through COVID-19 with all its attendant effects, poverty. You know, the factories are not working, the economy is grounding to the whole of Africa. Mm. And people are sick, and the people have no food, people have no money to take their children to school, the schools are shut, even if they had money to take them to school. So obviously Africa is going through a lot of problems. Let's talk about our country, Zambia.
Yeah.
I was talking to Father Kilinde just before our program here, about a program that he's carrying on together with his colleague, where they are going around Zambia and looking for the falls, you know, where the water drops from up there. You know, the world is crazy about falls.
Yes.
If you could tell the world that Zambia has got more than the Victoria Falls, that we've got thousands of falls in every province of Zambia, can you imagine how many people are going to come here?
True.
So I was telling Father Kirinda, please continue with this. Document all this. Let the Ministry of Tourism and the Ministry of Finance help you to use this to publicize Zambia. Why? Because we Zambians don't see any good in ourselves anymore. We don't see any good in our country. Everything is bad just because we have problems. I think that we must realize that we still have the most beautiful country. When God was allocating He gave us one of the best. Now, I've been to some nice little countries. It's very, very nice, and so on. Zambia is as good as them. So we must appreciate what we have. Of course, we have problems, even political problems. Why don't we try to emulate those who solve their problems in a better way than the way we are solving ours? Solving ours with hatred, with segregation, with the isolation, this one belongs there, this is that tribe, this and that. And why are we taking sides with evil against good? You will recall that recently we had people who were killed. And I listened very carefully to the people who were reacting to this. The majority of the poor Zambians, the silent Zambians, didn't say anything about this. But a few of my political friends, instead of saying we are sorry that something like this can happen in our country, that people can be killed and burned, whatever is the reason, and I'm not here to defend anybody, I say Zambia should not be that kind of country where anybody from anywhere, whatever color, whatever religion, whatever nationality, comes to Zambia. As they enter the airport here in Zambia, or at the station in Lusaka, or in Livingstone, or in Chiriabombo, wherever, they must feel secure. They must feel that the Zambian people are good people. And I have heard many people saying that. But there are some who want to spoil our name by now going around and picking people by differences. Yeah, this one is this color.
Yeah.
This one is that religion. And I'm begging my young Zambians who still got energy to make speeches and to go around everywhere that spread the message of Zambia as a great country which welcomes everyone. Make the laws to deal with those that don't follow what Zambia should do. but don't advocate violence against these people.
Beautiful. Now let's talk about your passion. Yes. I call it your love of sport.
Sport, very much.
Especially.
And you know the funny thing about my love for sport, I was the worst sportsman.
I never played football.
No, I never won any race running around. I never played football. I didn't play basketball. I didn't work.
So how did you fall in love with it?
But well, even you too. Yeah, you played all this, but you love football or basketball or something. I fell in love with sport, especially the sports where a lot of people come together.
Uh-huh.
It's football, boxing, where people meet and they're all happy and so on. Mm. I fell in love with people and their love for sports.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
So it had everything to do with people, not the actual sport.
Yeah, no, it's something to do with people.
Mm.
Yeah, even the popularity of the sport is something to do with people.
People.
Yeah, if people like a sport, the sport grows.
Yeah.
So, like now, football is the number one sport here because the majority of Zambians like
football.
Which is my biggest passion was, of course, football.
Yeah.
But I also like boxing.
Boxing.
I have little boxing matches with friends, fights in the streets. Uh-huh. I grew up in the compound and we used to fight.
Mm-hmm.
But sports is very important. And as I started having my own children, I realized how important sports were.
Mm.
My children, I encouraged them. Play rugby, football, athletics, all the things that the kids do.
Mm.
And I did everything I could when I had a bit of political power to support them.
True. Any football team that you support in the English Premier League?
Yes, I've got two teams there.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I've got two teams, Arsenal and
Arsenal.
Manchester City. Yes, I know.
Manchester City, of course, I support Manchester City.
Those are my two, you asked me.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And for Zambia?
Zambia, you know, I'm a little bit disappointed with my country because I know that there is no country which can claim to have better footballers than Zambia.
You think so?
But yes, of course.
We've never had any player in the English Premier League.
Yeah, never mind about that. But we won the Africa Cup. And you don't win that cup unless you've got the right people. We have. What we are talking about now is why not? Uh-huh. Why don't we have any players in the in the Premiership?
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we have players in the French League and in the rest of the other countries which are much smaller than us? With less facilities, they don't have stadia that we have.
Mm.
They don't have the companies which are there to, which can be mobilized to support.
Yeah.
They don't have as big companies as we have here.
Mm.
Big farms, big mines, and big factories we have here.
Exactly.
But we need to organize all these things. Zambia can. What we did in Gabon.
In 2012.
In 2012, the way I was there.
Oh, were you there?
And by the way, I was sent there by Mr. Sata.
Ah,
he called me to say, you like football, I don't like. So I will give you a ticket to go with Kaunda to go and see it. And we went to witness a fantastic victory.
Did you think that team would win?
Yes, I have always, don't forget that many of those players, I know them personally, I know their families, I know everything, because my passion was football so much, and then my son, Nenani, decided to go a step further than me by forming a football academy, Chiparamba Football Academy, and invited me to be the chairman of Chiparamba. I still am the chairman of Chiparamba.
Wow.
And many of those players, five of those players who went to Gabon, were part of the Chiparamba Academy.
Wow. Beautiful.
And we played against all those other players in their various clubs or academies. So I know the players, I know them very well, and I know how able they are.
Beautiful.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, what is your final remarks? Before we even get to the final remarks, I know you like singing. You have such a rich...
I have a husky voice.
Yes, but you still sing, isn't it?
Yeah, I sing a little bit at home.
Do you have any particular favorite songs that you could...
You know, when you like things, like football, it's very difficult to choose which team you want or which footballer is the best footballer. Because you like something in this one, somewhere. But I just want to tell you something. I have a very strange gift from God he has given me and my wife. It's our little daughter. If you ask her to sing, she's shy, she will not agree. But if you just keep every night when I'm in my bedroom,
yeah,
either watching TV or something, she's in her room alone. I hear a beautiful voice going through the house. And so she's such a fantastic singer. And in her school in England, she's won accolades.
Wow.
For singing.
Is she picking up from daddy who doesn't want
I don't
to
know,
sing?
But I'm saying it's a gift to me because, can you imagine, I like music so much. And then in my own house, one of my twins
can
is
sing.
A fantastic singer.
Okay, so
and sometimes I hear the brother twin humming behind, supporting the sisters.
So what kind of music do you listen to?
I like most of the music, but you know, when I was young, we were growing up, people like Vernon Mwanga, and people like Moton Kama, people like Alina Nisimbule, and so on. We're young like yourselves.
Yes.
And we used to enjoy
going
to jazz music. When we go to America, we used to go to jazz festivals. And I really love jazz.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but all music.
Okay.
Yes. I like church music now. There's a lot of beautiful music, out of churches.
Zambian music as well?
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. You know, again, who introduced me to Zambian music? I didn't know there was so much music here until I started going out with this young lady. Sometimes when you have a young wife.
Yeah, they'll
and
take
then
you.
I noticed she's playing music. And, they, oh, and I said, there's so much music in Zambia.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so I have a lot of it.
Oh,
she
wow.
collects a lot of music from all, and many of the artists, I know them personally.
Wow.
They visit me, etc. Mm-hmm. And then I like the music from this church, from the Seventh-day Adventist.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like Davis, Blaya, and they invite me to their concerts when they have a big festival of music in the big hall here. They always invite me. I always go. Yes.
To listen to their music.
Beautiful voices.
Very soothing.
Yes,
and it just
gives
you this peace.
Yes.
Okay, now, what is your message to the country? We still consider you as Zambia's most powerful person.
Yeah, my message, and I heard when you called me and I said, I'm going to use this opportunity to pass this message.
True.
Yes. But first of all, before I pass that message, I want to say this, that our forefathers, our ancestors, or those who were politicians before us, were very wise people. And it was through this wisdom that they were able to unite the whole country, whether it's called Zambia, whether it's called Ghana, whether it's called Egypt, whether it's called Tanzania, in the case of Nyerere, and so on, so on. The first thing, you must mobilize the people to come together, so that you can unseat the colonialists or the imperialists, as we used to call them. And they were able to do that by bringing us together. Now we have big enemies. We've got enemies of disease, enemies of poverty, and et cetera, et cetera. And then unemployment for the young people. You know, see how many of your own children, when they are finished, you have a headache. What is it going to do? Et cetera, et cetera. So I think that all our leaders must commit themselves to bringing Zambians together, back together. They must bring unity amongst the Zambians. These material things they're talking about, there's a limit to them. We can't forget about our unity as Zambians, all of us. You know, the beauty about this country is that it's one of the few countries where I can say before this that we didn't have tribalism. We didn't, yes, when I hear your name, I can say, Nimono Omlozu. Or I hear your name, I say, Msonda Udani Mwemba, and so on. Or I hear this is Mainza Utawani Mtonga. Yes, but that never separated us.
Yeah.
It, in fact, motivated us to go out of our way to bring them each other together. So that's my message. We have a year more to go, a year and a half or so before the election. Number one call from people like myself is that we pray to God to give us the ability to get our people to come together and realize that this Zambia belongs to all of them. And the aim of the elections is not to win all, the election is to choose a leader, because we chose that as a method of choosing, that we'll go to the election. We'll go there with our different candidates. Once the people, the Zambian people have chosen, all of us must come together and respect that leader and ask him to lead us to prosperity and unity and peace and justice. Mm. Yes.
Wow, that's so powerful. You know, I never dreamt in my wildest dream that today I'll sit with Arabi and have this interview with you.
Thank you.
I'm so grateful.
Me too, I didn't know that.
That you talk to Mwanga. But God saw it fit, I think.
Thank you.
And we are so grateful that you came to Loyola TV and had this interview.
It's a great TV. Wish it all the best to play its role in helping the Zambian people to appreciate their country to appreciate each other.
Thank you so
much.
Yes,
yes.
Thank you.
If you ask me what I miss most as president, what I enjoyed most as a politician and as a president was the ability to be in Northern Province today and enjoy with the people of the Northern Province, sing their songs, dance with them, eat their food and so. And the next week or so, sit with the people of Luapula and enjoy with the people of Luapula. Thereafter, the people of Northwestern, thereafter, Western, Southern, Eastern. I think it's so wonderful that Zambia has a collection of all these wonderful tribes, and the way they eat, the way they sing, the way they dance, which we Zambians should enjoy.
Wow.
Everything. That I miss.
Wow. So could you speak any of the languages other than Zenga?
Yes, you know, unfortunately for this president of yours, like I told you, I was not born here. And I've never hidden this fact. I was born in Zimbabwe.
Okay.
My first language was actually Ndebele. And of course, Nsenga, Ngoni, Chewa, I learned it in my home because of my parents.
Yeah.
And then they sent me to school to the Eastern Province where I got to learn about it. Then I went to Munali, where I met the Lozi, Sulwale, Lundas, Tongas, everybody. So I can pick around here. I understand most of the languages of Zambia very well. But I also am a linguist. I speak Zulu very well, because Zulu is the same language as Ndebele.
Yeah.
Ndebele and Zulu is the same language as Shangani. Shangani, Ndebele, Zulu is the same language as Zulu. Zulu and all these languages, the same language as Xhosa. So these languages here from South Africa, they are the same. If you know one, you know all of them. The same language as Swazi. So when we arrive in Swaziland, they will be talking about you and me, I'll be hearing.
Whoa.
So I'm lucky, I'm fortunate, and I can speak Shona because I was born in Zimbabwe as well. So I know a lot of languages from outside. I can speak a bit of Amharic from Ethiopia because I went to university in Ethiopia. I can speak a bit of Swedish because I went to university in Sweden.
Oh, wow.
And then a bit of French because I studied French at the University of, not at the University, at Munali when I was there.
So you have a mix.
Student, so I know many languages.
Beautiful.
And I'm very proud to be an internationalist.
Wow.
Yes.
What would you like to be remembered for, finally, as you come to an end?
I'd like to be remembered as mainly as a parent. The one thing that losing election has done to me, it has given me the opportunity to enjoy my family, to enjoy my children, to enjoy my sisters, to enjoy my brother. I have only one brother left, James. To enjoy my brother. Every day I call him to say, how are you? And so on and so on. I like to really be remembered as a parent. And my twins have given me the greatest joy that anybody can ask for.
Wow.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
It was great having you on Ignite with Mwangala. So there you have it. I was talking to the fourth Republican president of Zambia, Mr. Rupiah Bwezani Banda, commonly known as RRB. This has been Mwangala Chakalashi Santos on Ignite with Mwangala. Join me for yet another exciting episode.